Today we're going to be doing the newborn cardiovascular examination. We'll start with observation, we'll move to inspection, and then auscultation. We typically don't do percussion in the newborn cardiovascular exam. There are a lot of things that I could cover with observation, but those can be covered other times, such as dysmorphic appearance and things of that nature. So we'll be really focusing more in on the cardiovascularly specific things to be looking for. So as we begin with our observation, first thing we want to note is, how does the child look? Is he comfortable? Is he breathing normally? Is he cyanotic or not? Does he look dysmorphic? Is he overly large or small? Get a general sense of how the child looks. Dysmorphic features, as I mentioned, are important because a lot of genetic syndromes do come with cardiovascular disease, specifically congenital heart disease, but that's for another time. As we focus in, again, we're looking for cyanosis, but also if we look at the precordium, if a child has a large heart, you may actually see a bulge in the chest wall. You may see some abnormality, even let's say ectopia cordis, where the heart is outside of the chest. Obviously, that's going to jump out at you, or it should. If you pay close enough attention, you may see the PMI, point of maximal impulse. It's on the left, or it could be on the right if we're dealing with dextrocardia. So those are things to be looking for when it comes to observation. What's the child's color? Does perfusion look good? Are the lower extremities dusky? Are we dealing with something that might be a ductus arteriosus with reversal of flow and cyanosis in the lower extremities? Are we seeing the ischemic sort of appearance from severe coarctation, things of that nature? So that's something to be thinking about, and a number of things actually to be thinking about as we do the observation in the newborn cardiovascular examination. As we move along now to palpation is going to be a fairly minimal amount of the examination. The first thing that I typically would do is check the pulses. So in a newborn, you're going to want to check the pulses at the brachial arteries, here and here. Additionally, you'll want to check them at the femoral and brachial to make sure that you have simultaneous pulsation in the right upper extremity and one of the femoral arteries. It does not have to be the right, it could be the left or the right. But you want the simultaneous arrival of that pulse. If the lower extremity is delayed, then that is an indicator of coarctation of the aorta. You also want to make sure that they're equal throughout. You should feel the amplitude being about the same. So that's the first thing that I would do with palpation. The second thing would be to palpate the precordium. Obviously, in a neonate, putting your whole hand on the chest is not going to be of much use. And so then moving to the distal interphalangeal joints and just palpating lightly across the precordium to see, can you feel the PMI? What does it feel like? Is it on the left or the right side? Do you feel a thrill or anything of that nature? Then palpating the liver to see if the liver is enlarged. One thing that I meant to mention with regards to palpation and the pulses is, if a patient has a large ductus arteriosus because they're freshly born, then you will feel prominent pulses. It's the pulse pressure, the difference between the systolic and the diastolic blood pressure, that gives you a pulse that you can palpate. So a blood pressure that's 100 over 25 is going to give you a pulse that you can palpate much more readily than a blood pressure that's, say, 200 over 160, because the pulse pressure, the difference between the two, is greater in the 100 over 25 scenario. That covers the things that we really would typically be doing with regards to palpation on the newborn cardiovascular examination. Now we're going to do auscultation in the newborn cardiovascular examination. The first thing that we want to do when we're listening is to try to frame systole and diastole. That is the cardiac cycle. Systole is defined by the closure of the atrial ventricular valves, mitral or tricuspid. And diastole is initiated with the closure of the semilunar valves, aortic and pulmonary valve. When we talk about systole and diastole, we're really talking about ventricular systole and ventricular diastole, because atrial systole and diastole are occurring at different times from that. In addition to the four cardinal listening areas, it's important to actually listen throughout the precordium, because the heart is actually positioned differently in each child. And the truth is, the valves that we ascribe to the different listening areas don't actually live there, if you were to actually look at this anatomically. And so there's a lot of real estate to be covered, because certain things like a patent ductus arteriosus, you may hear in the infraclavicular area on the left side. Ventricular septal defects may be at the mid-sternal border, especially if they're muscular in nature. Mitral regurgitation, while at the apex, may actually be heard best in this size of a patient, in the axilla. And so it's important to auscultate throughout the precordium. Other things that you could potentially do are to listen over the abdomen to see if you hear any bruits or anything of that nature. If you have a patient who has severe aortic stenosis, you may actually listen even to the top of the head, as there may be radiation of the murmurs there. Obviously, we want to listen to the lung sounds to make sure that the breath sounds are good and we don't hear any evidence of fluid overload or abnormality there. Additionally, in the setting of coarctation, you can hear the murmur radiate down the spine toward the lower back. In the setting of pulmonary stenosis, you can hear that radiate to the back as well. If it's peripheral pulmonary stenosis, you'll hear a sound more laterally. If it's more a left pulmonary stenosis, left pulmonary artery stenosis, or pulmonary valve stenosis, you might hear it directed straight toward the left scapula. Now let's take a minute to talk about cardiac murmurs, because what kind of examination would we be doing of the cardiovascular system if we didn't discuss that? There are a number of murmurs that we might hear in a newborn, one of the most common being that of a patent ductus arteriosus. We would typically hear that at the left infraclavicular area, and that's going to sound, as you've probably heard, like a machinery type murmur that is continuous, and the sound is sort of like, and that would be typical of a patent ductus arteriosus. If we listen over the right upper sternal border at the second intercostal space and we hear a somewhat higher frequency murmur that's crescendo decrescendo, such as, then we may be dealing with aortic valve stenosis. Similarly, pulmonary valve stenosis can sound the same. So it's going to be an upstroke and a downstroke, where it's louder sort of in the middle and then gets quieter. If we're listening for mitral regurgitation, it's going to be holosystolic, typically kind of harsh, and radiate to the left axilla. Tricuspid regurgitation isn't as easy to hear, but it will usually have a lower frequency, but have the same quality, that is holosystolic. If you have a muscular VSD, which is very common in the newborn, especially right here, sort of mid-sternal border, psh, 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 tiny little muscular VSD, if you hear a lower frequency holosystolic sound, it could be a larger VSD in this setting. But when the pulmonary vascular resistance is elevated in the newborn, you may not hear a VSD at all. And in fact, it may be a few days before the VSD would come out. So those are the most common, I would say, murmurs that you would hear in patients of this age, with the exception of peripheral pulmonary stenosis, which you're going to hear out in the axilla and the back bilaterally. And that's going to be a high frequency sound, sort of pew, 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 like that. And that covers the murmurs.